So let's start. Why don't you share with us some of the best memories that you have in Mexico before you came to the United States with your family, Francisco?
Mm-hmm. Well, I was only 4 years old when we crossed the border, so I have some memories from my childhood. I recall living in the outskirts of El Rancho Blanco, called Las Fuentes, and lived in a adobe cabin or adobe hut with no electricity, dirt floor. We had candlelight, and to get water, we used to have to go down to the river to get the water. So it was a very simple life, but also a hard life. And so that's why my father decided to make the trip to California, hoping to leave our poverty behind and starting a new and better life. So we took the second class train from Guadalajara to Mexicali, and then waited till the night. So we traveled, I forget, that was quite a distance away from the border patrol station. And my dad dug a hole underneath the fence, and we slithered through it like snakes. And on the other side, a woman who my father had contacted in Mexicali picked us up and drove us to Santa Maria, where we began our new life. And in Santa Maria, we lived in a migrant camp called Tent City. The migrant camp was owned by Chihi, who parceled out the acres of strawberries to sharecroppers, Japanese sharecroppers. And so we picked strawberries for Ito, and we lived in tent in this migrant camp. The tent that you see there to your right is the tent that we lived in. The tall boy that you see there, that's Roberto, my older brother, and I'm Trampita in front of my brother.
So how many brothers, Nancy? How many of you were?
There are five boys and one girl. Uh-huh. Yeah. And then next to my to Roberto is Panchito, the one wearing suspenders. That's yours truly. Yeah. So that's where we began our new life, picking strawberries. I want to show you another picture. This picture was taken the year that I went to Santa Clara University for my undergraduate studies. My mother was still picking strawberries. That's my mother. Uh-huh. And the little boy with the blue shirt, that's my little brother, Ruben. So then after the strawberry season would be over, we would move to the San Joaquin Valley, around the Fresno area, Merced, Cinco Puntas, Corcoran. And Corcoran, in these little towns, we would pick grapes for raisins, mm-hmm. as you see in this picture. We used to get a penny and a half for each one of these paper trays.
Right.
So I can go on and give you the whole summary, but I'll stop there.
What were those things, Francisco, that you were amazed when you arrived to the United States? How much did you know about the United States when you arrived here, being a child? What surprised you, and what makes you like maybe feel afraid or scared?
Yeah. Well, as I say, I was fairly young. Mm-hmm. But my father used to talk about moving to the United States, and he would always say that people there can make a better life. And so when we made the trip, I was very excited, but also a little bit nervous because, and sad because I was leaving my cousins in Tlaquepaque, Mexico. So I had mixed emotions. Mm-hmm. But I, as a child, I thought, well, once we cross the border, then things will be just beautiful, you know, because that's what I had heard. And as you saw from these pictures, I was shocked that that life was really not as we expected it to be. Nevertheless, the difference was that there were more opportunities here in this country to improve our lives, more opportunities than where we lived in rural Mexico.
But what does it mean for you and maybe your mother being like, okay, we're coming to United States because we can get a better life, but you had to work in the fields as a child.
Yes.
Something that you were not doing in Mexico, right?
That's correct. Mm-hmm. That's correct. At the age of six, my older brother and I began working alongside our parents, picking strawberries and picking cotton, grapes, topping carrots, you know. And so it was necessary for the older children in our family to work during the harvest season because during the winter months, there's little or no work. Mm-hmm. So it was necessary to save as much money as we could right. during the harvest season in order to survive the winter months.
So how were you combining your work in the fields when your school? Like how was...
It wasn't easy. I missed school, and so did my older brother. I did not start school every year until the middle of November. That's why Thanksgiving is one of my favorite holidays.
Because you were going to.
I used to think, oh, it's almost Thanksgiving that I'm going to go back to school. Uh-huh. So, because we spoke Spanish, only Spanish at home, and because I missed a lot of school, whenever I enrolled in school for the first time in the middle of November, I would always fall really far behind my classmates, and I was struggling with English language. As a matter of fact, when I first started first grade, I didn't know English well enough, so I had to repeat it. Mm-hmm. So it was, but we were surrounded by other migrant families and our way of life was, to me, normal because everybody around us lived that kind of life.
Most of them.
Most of them, uh-huh. Yes. And it was not until I was in the sixth grade uh-huh. when a classmate of mine invited me to his home. Which was nearby the school, and I had time before taking the school bus. And when I went in his home, I realized that not everyone lived the way we did, because here they had carpet, indoor plumbing, they had electricity, and I remember they had lamps, you know, not the one light bulb hanging from the ceiling, and then he had his own room. And most of the time, we only had cabins with one room. We all slept in the same place. So that's when I began to realize.
Was he Mexican or was he?
No, he's not. He was not Mexican. No.
He was not Mexican. And how was that experience for you? How his family treat you? Did you feel like some discrimination in this house, and also maybe at school?
Well, not in this situation. Eventually, I did experience prejudice mm-hmm. and discrimination. When I was in junior high, you know, that's when your heart begins to look for or is attracted to little girls. Uh-huh. And so the girl that I was attracted to, she, I guess she also was attracted to me. So she invited me to her home. And when she introduced me to her parents, there was dead silence. And so the parents said, so what's your nationality? And I said, well, I'm Mexican. I did dead silence again. The next day when I saw the little girl, she wouldn't talk to me.
Wow.
And I found out later that her parents didn't want her to see me anymore. My brother Roberto was in high school, a sophomore, and again, he had the same experience. He liked this girl and the girl liked him. And when the parents found out that he was Mexican, they forbade her from seeing him again. And the father, her father, told her that he would buy her a new car if she would stop seeing him. And she really loved my brother because she said, you know, I want to continue seeing you, but I can go to my friend's house and you can pick me up there and we can continue going out. And my brother did that once or twice and then he stopped. He said, I don't like this. I don't like to be hiding. And so they broke up. And so, you know, those were I experienced discrimination even in college.
Like what? Tell us some stories.
Well, I was used to belong to an organization called Sodality, and we used to have what they call cells, where a small group of students would get together and discuss different issues. And we were discussing religious differences. And I was a sophomore, I believe, and some of them were sophomores, juniors, and seniors. And one of the seniors said, we're talking about intermarriages and differences in religion. And he said to me, as he said to the group, well, he said, I wouldn't want my sister or my daughter to marry a Mexican. And I was speechless. So I walked out of the room, and others told him that I was Mexican. So I went down the hall, down the hallway, and he followed me and he apologized. He said, I didn't know you were Mexican. I said, you know, you have the problem. You have a problem. You know, but you know,
yeah.
I realized that prejudice and discrimination is based on ignorance.
Yes.
Yeah.
But the saddest thing is that we still live in that.
Yeah.
In these days. More in these days, right?
Yes.
And I have to say that you can see, like, Francisco Jiménez is kind of that not Mexican assumption that a lot of people has, because your skin is white, your green eyes, so maybe that's why he never thought about, like, were Mexican. You are Mexican.
Well, of course, because in Guadalajara, in the state of Jalisco, a lot of people look like me, and I even had a custodian in one of the elementary schools who was also Mexican. Mm-hmm. I include all of this in the book.
Right.
And he would say, you know, Francisco, you shouldn't tell people you're Mexican. You could get away, you know, because you're light.
Yeah.
And I said, no, but I'm proud to be Mexican.
Course.
My father says that you should be proud of being who you are. And he said, well, I mean, he didn't agree with me, but.
All those bad experiences that you have make you think about, like, how important it is to be educated and also to be bilingual?
Yes, all those experiences that I went through as a child really inform everything I do in my writing, in my teaching, in my public speaking. I try to show that we're all basically related. We're all the members of the same human family. And that we should look at differences with respect, and also welcome people who are different from us, because we can learn from them as well as they can learn from us. And so my efforts throughout my professional life is to create a more inclusive society. A society where no one is left out, a more just and humane society. Mm-hmm. So that's my, the things that I try to do.
Thank you, Francisco. And since I see some little boys and girls here, I would like you to share like how difficult it was for you going a little back from your first days or weeks at school. What were you facing besides like not having the English, the language, and like living in a poor situation with your parents and having to work in the fields before going to school? Like, maybe you can share all those things. Like, how was your life in those first weeks, months, or maybe years?
Well, they were very difficult. I hated missing school and finding myself behind all my classmates. And one of the things that I used to do in order to not be so far behind my classmates was that I used to carry a little notepad in my shirt pocket. Mm-hmm. And every day I would add a different English word in its definition. And as we worked in the fields, I would memorize those words to improve my English. And I added other things that I needed to learn in school. So, you know, in this, and as I relate in the book, we were living in Orosi in a migrant camp, and the place we lived in burned down. Mm-hmm. And I lost my little notepad. Yeah. And I was terribly upset and crying. And my mother, being very wise, said, "Well, Panchito, I know you're upset, but we should be thankful to God that none of us got hurt." I said, "Sí, mamá, pero es que he perdido mi libretita."
Yeah.
And so she looked me straight in the eye and she says, "Well, Panchito, do you recall what you wrote in your librito?" I said, "Pues sí, mamá." She says, "Well, then not everything is lost, mijo."
Right. Yes.
And so I thought about what she meant, and she was absolutely right. Right. That whatever I learned on my own, using that little libretita, and whatever I learned in school, that knowledge would go with me no matter how many times we would move. So in this very unstable life that we were experiencing, as a child, I always yearn for a place to call our own. I was tired of moving and missing school. I yearned for stability in my life. And where I found it was in education.
Right.
That whatever I learned on my own, whatever I learned in school, that knowledge would go with me no matter how many times we would move. So it's not surprising that I went into education.
Right. Education.
Yeah.
And books. And before I start, like, because we all want to know, like, how did you, or when did you decide to become a writer, and when did you start writing, in a professional way, I would like you, if you please can share the experience of the deportation of your father, I guess, only, or your parents.
Yes.
Because that's something that we, as an immigrant, we all know that it's happening.
Well, I was in the eighth grade, and my father couldn't continue working in the fields because he had severe back problems. So Roberto, my older brother, and I got jobs working as custodians to help support our family. So things were getting pretty stable, and we did not move. We stayed in Santa Maria. And unfortunately, when I was in the eighth grade, the Border Patrol came into the classroom and asked for me. And Mrs. Salis, whom I can show you the picture. Let's see. These are all the pictures I was going to talk about. This is where I was in school in Santa Maria and junior high in the eighth grade. And the teachers that you see here, Mrs. Salis in the picture, she was the one who painfully identified me when the Border Patrol came in. So at that moment, I thought my whole world had collapsed. And I wished that I had a different name. I didn't want to be who I was. So, walked out of the classroom, and then he got in the Border Patrol car. He drove to the high school, and then picked up my brother, who was in high school at that time. Then both of us then drove in his Border Patrol car to Bonetti Ranch, another migrant camp where we lived. And other Border Patrol officers had gathered other families in the ranch, including my family. And so we asked that we were taken to San Luis Obispo to be processed. Mm-hmm. My brother had to do the interpretation and asked if we could give us three days. Mm-hmm. To get things in order and that we would voluntarily go back. And so they said, okay, you have 3 days. So we crossed the border in Nogales, and that's how we got deported.
How long you stay in Mexico? Like
By then, my younger siblings were already born here. Mm-hmm. Ito, the Japanese sharecropper, for whom we picked strawberries, he became our sponsor and loaned us money so we could come back with our papers. Mm-hmm. And so it took several months. My parents then. This was during the late winter. Mm-hmm. My parents and younger siblings stayed in Guadalajara with my father's older sister. And Roberto and I came back by ourselves to Bonetti Ranch. And my brother was hoping to continue his job as the custodian. He was working for the Santa Maria Unified School District as a custodian. But when we came back, he discovered that he had lost his job because the principal said, well, you left and you didn't tell us anything. So it happened that the man they hired to replace my brother didn't work out. So
he got it.
So
back.
My brother got his job back.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that story that I know brings a lot of sad memories, but thank you for sharing that. And I'm just like curious, did you ever get another libretita? Because all these stories that you're sharing with us, I know they are part of the books.
Yes.
And did you get another libretita and you were writing everything that was happening to you?
Well, no, actually, I started doing that again when I went to college. Mm-hmm. I should tell you that during the 4 years in high school, I worked as a custodian, and so did my older brother. 35 hours a week each to support our family. So when I graduated from high school, I wanted to go to college, but I wasn't sure I was able to because I was still supporting my family. So through the advice of my high school counselor, I gave my janitorial job to Trampita, my little brother, and he agreed to take it. So I got some local scholarships. Great. And borrowed money to go to pay for my first year in college. When I went to Santa Clara University, at the advice of Mr. Penny, my high school counselor, I had never heard of Santa Clara before, but he wanted me to go there because it's a private Catholic small school. I found myself out of place. You know, everybody around me seemed so much smarter than I. And in moments when I felt discouraged and guilty because here I was living in a nice dormitory, Kennel Hall, where I have my office now.
Yes.
In Kennel Hall.
I've been there.
You know, having three meals a day, needing as much as you wanted to for the same price, and knowing that my parents were still struggling economically, I felt guilty. And so, you know, I had doubts about my own academic ability. So in moments like that, that's when I began to reflect on my childhood experiences to give me the courage not to give up.
Yes.
And I began writing those recollections. And I compare my situation then to a man who is drowning. You know, a man who is drowning uses the water, the very substance that threatens his life, to save himself, right? So likewise, the experiences that I had as a child and as an adolescent that were initially pulling me back, pulling me down, I use them to boost myself up, to save myself. And that's, so, you know, I would refer to those childhood reflections or recollections to not give up. Mm-hmm. And so I kept doing that during those 4 years. And then when I went to graduate school, I found myself in the same situation my first year in graduate school, feeling the same way I did my first year in as undergraduate. Mm-hmm. And so I can refer to those apuntes, those
notes,
scribbles, for the same reason. I happened to show them to my thesis advisor, Andres Duarte, who had been the director of the Palacio de Bellas Artes in Mexico. Thanks to him, he was also a writer. And I showed him my recollections, written recollections, and he said, "Panchito, I think you should put them together and publish them." And I thought, well, I don't know. But I felt, well, he's a writer. He must see something that's worth doing. So as soon as I began to bring those recollections into some kind of order and began writing, I immediately realized that I wasn't writing just for myself, that I was writing the experiences of many, many families that I had grown up with, and many families who continued working in the fields just like I did many years ago. And so that was the encouragement for me to write, to put those experiences in book form, like in the circuit, knowing that I was writing the experiences of many, many people who work very, very hard, you know, from sun up to sundown for very low wages, living in poor living conditions, And what sustains these families day in and day out is the hope and dreams of having a better life for their children and their children's children. So for me, in my writing, I try to pay tribute to these families and to and they're an inspiration to me. So that's why I began writing consistently. At that time, I was still writing my PhD dissertation, and I knew that I couldn't continue writing those stories. I needed to concentrate in my writing, that finishing my doctoral dissertation, if I wanted to continue my profession in college and university teaching. So I postponed writing at that point. I finished the doctorate and had two children with my beautiful wife, Laura, mm-hmm. who's sitting there. in New York. And then we came back to Santa Clara. I was hired at the University of Santa Clara University and began teaching and then got into administration. And for those 20 years as working as a teacher and being in administration, I finally took my first sabbatical. And it was then that I began consistently writing other stories that I put together and published the circuit, right. Stories from the Life of a Migrant Child.
Thank you, Francisco. I really want to just bring again what you just said, that I think it's beautiful that he's not saying like, I am writing because I want the people in the fields or the children's to be inspired by me, but you say in the opposite way, like they are your inspiration. And he told me the same when I first interviewed him and when we were airing that interview on the TV. And that was for me amazing that he was saying that you were dedicating the award, but you were also saying that they inspire you. And I, believe me, as an interviewer, as a journalist, I keep always listening the opposite. So thank you so much for saying that, Francisco. But there's a story that you share with me and I would like you to share now, because I remember you mentioned that you had a teacher that she was reading your story and she asked you, did you write this? And it was about your brothers, your yes. family, and that she gave you a book mm-hmm. by Steinbeck, actually.
Yes, that's right. That's
Tell
right.
us about yeah. that.
I was a sophomore in high school mm-hmm. and had a excellent but very difficult, very demanding teacher. Her name was Mrs. Bell. We used to call him La Señorita Campana. And one of the assignments she gave us was to write something that happened to us, something that we experienced. So I wrote about my little brother who almost died when we were living in a migrant camp. And so at that time, I was still having difficulty with some of the grammar. I turned in the essay, and then the following, about a week later, she came in and handed out the results for around the class to return the papers. And she asked me to stay afterwards. And I said, well, boy, now I'm in really trouble. Because, you know, my papers would come back with all kinds of corrections. Uh-huh. So after the student, everybody left, and I approached her, and then she said, Francisco, is this a true story? And I said, yes, it is. She got choked up.
I bet.
And she said, well, you know, if you continue working as hard as you are working, you're going to succeed. Then she said something that I'll never forget, to change my life. She says, you have writing talent. Yeah, writing.
We should thank Señorita Campana.
Yeah. Yeah, writing class. And then that's when she gave me the to read the novel by John Steinbeck, The Grapes of Wrath. Uh-huh. And I took it, and it was very thick.
You were like, oh.
And so when I started reading it, it was very difficult because there were many words I didn't know. So I had to look up many words, but I couldn't put that word down because I could relate to what I was reading. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a story in that novel is about a family from Oklahoma, mm-hmm. who during the Dust Bowl came to California,
right.
And they were migrant workers, and they suffered in discrimination because they were the Okies, the white Okies, you know, and then they suffered injustices. And so I said, well, that's my story. That's my story. And so for the first time, I realized the power of literature and to move hearts and minds. Mm-hmm. And for the first time, I realized that my own story was part of the American story, that there were other people in our country who had gone through the same experiences that my family was going through.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that novel made a world of difference for me, and she, Mrs. Bell, planted the seed in my mind that perhaps someday I would write that story.
Yes.
And so there's
with the very big difference that Steinbeck saw that from far away, and you were living that experience
from inside.
So that's a right. Very huge difference, I guess, for me and.
Yeah,
I guess for everyone. So what do you think, what did you feel like when you realized that you were going to be the first Mexican to get this Steinbeck Award?
I was emotional and at the same time excited and felt very, what's the word? I can't explain the emotion that I felt because getting the John Steinbeck Award here from an award that was established in memory of John Steinbeck, the writer whose novel really made a world difference in my life. And so it was an affirmation that my writing and my purpose for writing was affirmed by that award. Mm-hmm. You know, that award really belonged not just to me, but to all of the people, the community that I write about. Mm-hmm. It was really their award. It was also an award that had its roots in Mrs. Bell. Mm-hmm. In my parents and many, many people who along the way guided me and gave me the courage and the guidance to get a good education so that then I could write, mm-hmm. and then pay tribute to the families, the people who made it possible for me to break the migrant circuit or the poverty, the cycle of poverty. So when I got the award, I thought, yes, this is an affirmation of an award that belongs to all these people, Mrs. Bell, Mr. Penny, my parents especially, and my brother, mm-hmm. my teachers, right? So I felt very good about it. And then when I saw the list of previous recipients, I said, no, I maybe they made a mistake. I don't belong here. Because
Dolores
Springsteen Werner was the first one to get it.
Right.
And then
Dolores
Huerta. Who are some of the others? Ken Burns. Joan Baez, and the award is given to writers and artists whose work promotes social justice.
Right.
Works that deal with the spirit of and the value of those who are marginalized. Mm-hmm. So that's all I thought, this is a wonderful award.
That means you are doing a great job. So how do you connect this? How would you connect the social justice work that you have been doing with also the hard job that you have been doing as a professional in order to tell everyone how important it is to be bilingual and to be educated? And again, how do you combine those things or make the connection with the social justice, education, and bilingual?
Well, that's a very good question. I think I've always been supportive of a bilingual education. When Jerry Brown was governor his first term, he appointed me to the California Commission on Teacher Credentialing, which is the agency that establishes the standards for credentialing teachers and administrators in the state of California. And I served on it for 10 years. And during that period of time, bilingual education was became a state mandate. And so the commission was responsible for establishing the requirements for credentialing bilingual teachers. And so I was a strong voice on that commission for bilingual education and establishing the requirements that would prepare bilingual teachers to be well informed and to have the sensitivity for the different cultures that are represented in our state. And I did so because, again, referring to my own childhood experience, having to struggle with English language when at that time we were, as children were not allowed to speak our native language. Spanish. And as a matter of fact, we were punished sometimes for if we spoke in, another language other than English in the schools. And I felt that that was a traumatic experience for me. So I felt that it's important for teachers to value the child's native language while they're learning English, and hopefully help the child to maintain their native language while they learn English to become bilingual. Because by being bilingual, it's a big advantage. I find that students who major in a foreign language, who are, let's say, who are non-native speakers of Spanish but major in Spanish, they see the world in much a broader sense. They embrace cultural differences, and language communicates culture. So if we are not encouraged, or if our native language is not valued, the message as children is that we as children are not valued, our culture is not valued. Mm-hmm. So that's why I have always been supportive of bilingual education. And the second part of your question was, how does that relate?
Yeah, do you connect that with the social justice?
Yeah. Well, when you study American history in its truest form, not as an alternative reality, but it's
alternative.
you discover that we are a nation of immigrants for the most part, except for the exception of Native Americans and African Americans, and Irish, different ethnic groups that came to this country suffered discrimination. The Irish, the Italians, and they struggled and they worked hard because they wanted a better life for their children. So it seems to me that when we begin to learn about the experiences of the different groups that make up our diverse society, we begin to make connections that even though we are different, we have a lot in common. There are a common history in many ways. And so even though we come from different parts of the world, speak in a different language, and it's precisely those differences that makes our nation the rich nation that it is. And so when we make connections, then we begin to destroy those walls that separate us from one another. Mm-hmm. And instead of building walls, we build bridges, yeah. Right?
So after all these minutes that you have shared all your experience, good experience and bad experience in the school with the teachers, sometimes the discrimination, what would you say are the most biggest or the most big challenges that we have now as an immigrants, but mostly thinking about the foreign immigrant students, and not only immigrants, those ones that are undocumented and are in like elementary school, high school, college, university?
Well, it hurts me. My heart pains for these individuals because especially for all immigrants, we should value them, respect them, and appreciate all the things that they have brought to this country. And we are benefiting from all the contributions that all the different immigrants have made in agriculture, in architecture, in music, for example, in art. All those contributions make us who we are, and when immigrants are discriminated against, or when students who are here, who are brought here as children, who are without documentation, and the fear that they have of being deported, I can relate to those fears. And I've been working with different students, DACA students, encourage them to tell their stories. And my hope is that by telling their stories, that they can increase the compassion or create more compassion for the situation in which they find themselves. And that, we're living in a very difficult time now, but it's rather than to feel fear, we should use the opportunity to double our efforts to overcome injustice. Double our efforts to fight against discrimination and prejudice, because that's not a situation that is good for all people. It's not a good situation for our democracy. Our democracy is suffering as a result of what's going on, it seems to me. And so we have to do everything we can as individuals to overcome that situation and not lose hope. I think we have to. We are a nation that, as I mentioned earlier, that has worked really hard, suffered discrimination and prejudice in our history. So knowing that, then we should do everything within our power to change that situation so that no one suffers. Because if one suffers, we all suffer, right? I mean, So we just double our efforts, do everything we can. I on the way here, we saw people with signs you know.
Yeah, coming to the protest.
Yeah, protesting. And I think it's healthy to see protesters asking for social justice, protesting against injustices. And what I don't agree with is the violence. I don't think it serves us well. Destroying or breaking windows and so forth. That just feeds into the current administration's justification for doing what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yes.
But. To maintain a healthy democracy, we need to do everything possible to help everyone get the best education possible, right? And to contribute to our society as citizens, and to always look beyond ourselves and help others. Who need our help. Everything that's attributed to me in terms of success, I really owe it to many people. I couldn't have done it by myself, right? Mm-hmm. We can't. We need each other.
Mm-hmm.
So when I hear people say, "Well, I made it, so can you?" and I say, "I made it without a lot of help." So I will do everything I can do to help you succeed. Because to say, "I made it, so can you," is really absolving ourselves from the responsibility that we have to each other.
Right, yes.
Right?
Well, I know many of you are waiting for him or for us to finalize, to finish this conversation so you can talk to him and get a book and sign. But I would like, first of all, I want to say three more things. First, because I know you brought a lot of images and maybe you just want to go and share something with the people.
Just quickly, I'll share some
quickly.
That's the story. They're narrated from the child's point of view. Now this is the second book. The first book ends with eighth grade. This one is my experiences in high school during those 4 years. It's in Spanish with the title Senderos Fronterizos. This is the third book where I describe my experiences in college. And it's in Spanish with the title Más Allá de Mí. This is the picture that appears in my naturalization papers. I became an American citizen when I was a sophomore or junior in college.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the latest book to have taking hold, where I describe my experiences at Columbia University during the 60s. My participation or my support of the riots, not the riots, but the protests against the Vietnam War, the tragedy when Martin Luther King was assassinated. So I talk about what my reflections during that chaotic period of history.
Mm-hmm.
And what the common theme in all four books is the transformative power of education.
Mm, great.
Right? That's junior, each one of the books at the different stages of education. And so I, for those young people who are here, my advice is, take advantage of your education, work hard in your studies, and you will succeed. You have to believe in yourselves, be proud of who you are, be proud of your heritage, and be thankful to your parents and ancestors for all the sacrifices that they made so that you are in school. I have that privilege of being in school, and And that's why I have devoted most of my life to promoting education and the importance of literacy, because literacy is extremely important if we are going to maintain a good and healthy democracy.
Exactly. Thank you. Just one more question. Are you working in a book now in these days? I know you are very busy, but perhaps you are with your libretita.
Laura, my wife, and I had this discussion the other day. I was saying, I get many requests to make presentations, to visit schools, and I take advantage of doing that because it gives me a chance to promote education, right. But at the same time, it takes me away from writing. So I have to figure out a way to do both. But I do have ideas for another one.
Okay, mm-hmm. We look forward for that. Thank you so much for this conversation, and thank you. Thank you, Ricardo. Thank you, San Francisco Main Library.